This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, now we are going to see about the muscles of the larynx. Already we have seen the cartilages of larynx, ligaments, intrinsic ligaments and membranes and cavity of the larynx. So in this session, we are going to see about the muscles of the larynx. So the muscles of the larynx are grouped into two, extrinsic muscle and intrinsic muscle. Okay, so this extrinsic muscles are actually they are connected to the neighboring structure surrounding the larynx, and they are responsible for the movement of the larynx during phonation and swallowing. Okay, the intrinsic muscles are the one which is confined to the larynx in the attachment, but extrinsic will be attached to some other place other than larynx. Indirectly they will be related to laryngeal cartilage, or either origin will be in some place and insertion will be in the laryngeal cartilage. So first we'll see the extrinsic muscles. Okay, so the extrinsic muscles of larynx are the infrahyoid muscles. So you know there are four infrahyoid muscles. So you can see in this, this is the hyoid bone. So this muscles are the infrahyoid muscles. You can see the sternohyoid muscle. So the next muscle here is the thyrohyoid, and this is the sternothyroid muscle. So these are the three muscles which are grouped in the extrinsic muscles of larynx. Omohyoid is not involved directly, but it produces secondary movement. Okay, and the another muscle in the extrinsic group is the inferior constrictor muscle of the larynx. You can see this is the inferior constrictor muscle, and this muscle is the superior constrictor, this is the middle constrictor. So you know this inferior constrictor is attached both to the thyroid cartilage and to the cricoid cartilage. Okay, so now the extrinsic muscles of larynx are three infrahyoid muscles: sternohyoid, thyrohyoid, sternothyroid, and fourth one is the inferior constrictor muscle. Okay, and out of this, so these two muscles, sternothyroid and sternohyoid, they are depressors of the larynx. They are the depressors of the larynx. Okay, so the thyrohyoid and inferior constrictors are elevators of the larynx. Okay, now what are the other elevators of the larynx? Okay, so you know the muscles attached to the posterior border of lamina of thyroid cartilage. There are three muscles attached, so from above downwards, salpingopharyngeus, palatopharyngeus, and third one will be the stylopharyngeus. Okay, so out of this two muscle, palatopharyngeus, stylopharyngeus, are the elevators of the larynx. So other than this, these are all primary elevators. Secondary elevators are stylohyoid and mylohyoid. Okay, the muscle which is attached to the hyoid bone, stylohyoid, mylohyoid, and even the geniohyoid muscle also helps in elevation of the larynx. So not only this extrinsic muscles elevate and depress the larynx, it also affect the pitch and quality of the voice by rising or lowering the larynx. Okay, so actually this geniohyoid, it mainly elevates and it displaces the larynx during swallowing. So that is the main function of the geniohyoid. So now the extrinsic muscles are three sharp muscles, one inferior constrictor, and two muscles that are the elevators, palatopharyngeus and stylopharyngeus. The secondary elevators are the stylohyoid, mylohyoid, and geniohyoid. Okay, so with this we'll go on to the intrinsic muscles of the larynx. So the intrinsic muscles of the larynx are grouped into two. Okay, mainly they are grouped into two. One is the muscles which acts on vocal cord. Okay, so the next group is the out of this you have subgroups. So first we'll see the main group. So the intrinsic muscles are grouped into two: muscles which acts on vocal cord and muscles which act on epiglottis. Okay, so the muscle which act on vocal cord is again divided into two subgroups. So what are the two? Based on the actions of the vocal cord, we divide the muscles acting on vocal cord into two groups. So the muscles which abduct or adduct the vocal cord, and muscles which increase or decrease the tension of the vocal cord. So in muscles acting on vocal cord are again in, divided into two groups. So one which will do the abduction and adduction of the vocal cord, other which will do the changes the tension of the vocal cord. Okay. So the muscles acting on epiglottis also again grouped into two. The one which opens the laryngeal inlet, other one which closes the laryngeal inlet. Okay. So I think now you are clear. I think you are able to hear me. Shall I continue? No. No more queries now here. Okay. Okay. So now we'll see detailly about the muscles. So first we'll see the muscles which act on the vocal cord. So in that, I already said there are two groups. Muscles which do the abduction and adduction. The muscles which increase or decrease the tension of the vocal cord. So the muscles that abduct or adduct the vocal cord, in that, the muscle which abduct the vocal cord is the posterior cricoarytenoid muscle. Okay. Posterior cricoarytenoid. The muscle which adduct the vocal cord are the lateral cricoarytenoid and transverse arytenoid. Okay. So these are the muscles in the abduction and adduction. Next, the muscles which increase or decrease the tension of the vocal cords are the, so which tenses the vocal cord are two, cricothyroid, vocalis. Okay. And which relaxes the vocal cord are the thyroarytenoid. Okay. So I think now you are clear about the muscles acting on the vocal cord. They are posterior cricoarytenoid, lateral cricoarytenoid, transverse arytenoid, then thyroarytenoid, cricothyroid, and vocalis. Okay. So next we'll go on to the next group, the muscles which act on the epiglottis. So this is again subgroup into two, that open or closes the laryngeal inlet. So first we'll see the muscles which closes the inlet of the larynx. There are two muscles here. One is the oblique arytenoid and other one is the periepiglotticus. Okay. So the two muscles closing the inlet of larynx are oblique arytenoid and periepiglotticus. So the muscle which opens the inlet of larynx is the thyroepiglotticus. Okay. So that's all about the groups of the intrinsic muscles. So you have to mainly group into two, one acting on the vocal cord, other acting on the epiglottis. So out of all this muscle, the only muscle which is unpaired here is the transverse arytenoid muscle. All other muscles are paired muscle. Okay, you have to keep this in mind. The only muscle, intrinsic muscle of larynx, which is unpaired is the transverse arytenoid. All other muscles are paired muscles. Okay, now we will see individually about the each muscle. Okay. So first we'll see about the cricothyroid. So this comes under the group, that is muscle that acting on the vocal cord, that distenses the vocal cord. So you can see the cricothyroid muscle. Okay. So it has two types of fiber here. You can see this is the straight part and it is the oblique part. So it is cricothyroid. That means it arises from cricoid and gets inserted into the thyroid. Okay, so where from it arises? So it arises from the lateral surface of the arch of the cricoid cartilage. It arises from the lateral surface of the arch of the cricoid cartilage and even from the outer lip also. And if you see the direction of the fibers, it is directed backwards and upwards, and it is gets inserted into the lower border of the thyroid cartilage and even to the inferior corno of the thyroid cartilage. Okay, so clear about the origin and insertion. If you are not able to remember the origin insertion particularly, simply write cricothyroid. So origin from the arch of the cricoid cartilage, insertion into the lower border of the thyroid cartilage. So this is a simple way of reading the origin and insertion. Okay, so if you see the action of the cricothyroid muscle, it helps in the lengthening, and also through lengthening, it tenses the vocal cord. Okay, that's why this muscle is called tuning fork of the larynx. So this is mainly called as tensor of the vocal cord, and this muscle controls the tone and pitch of the voice. Okay, so that's all about the cricothyroid muscle. So next muscle we are going to see is the posterior cricoarytenoid muscle. So this comes under the group abductor of the vocal cord. Okay, so now you can see this is the posterior view of the larynx. This is the posterolateral view of the larynx. So you can see the posterior cricoarytenoid muscle. So this cartilage is the cricoid cartilage. This is the posterior lamina of the cricoid cartilage. You can see a raised ridge in the middle and two depressed area on either side. Okay. So now the posterior cricoarytenoid muscle, it arises from the posterior surface of the depressed area of the lamina of cricoid cartilage. And if you see the fibers direction, it passes upwards and laterally and gets inserted into the muscular process of the arytenoid muscle. Okay, that is back of the muscular process of arytenoid cartilage. Okay, so clear about the origin insertion. Simply, as I previously said, it arises from cricoid cartilage and gets inserted into the muscular process of the arytenoid cartilage. Okay. I think now you're clear about the origin insertion of the posterior cricoarytenoid. So next we'll see about the action. So it helps in the abduction of the vocal cord. Okay, so how it abducts the vocal cord? So actually it also through abduction, it also allows the entry of air through rhina glottidis in the respiratory tract. So if this muscle doesn't work, what happened? So abduction will not takes place automatically, the airway will be closed. So this results in breathing difficulty. Okay, so that's why the posterior cricoarytenoid muscle is called a safety muscle of larynx. Okay, so next we'll go on to the next muscle, lateral cricoarytenoid muscle. So posterior cricoarytenoids, it is located in the posterior part of the larynx. Lateral cricoarytenoid is located in the lateral part of the larynx. Okay, now after removing the thyroid lamina, you can see the right side thyroid lamina is removed. So you can see the arch of the cricoid cartilage, and this is the lamina, and you can see the arytenoid cartilage. This is the muscular process. So in the back of the muscular process, posterior cricoarytenoid gets inserted. In front of the muscular process, you can see the attachment of lateral cricoarytenoid. This muscle is the lateral cricoarytenoid. So now the lateral cricoarytenoid, it arises from the lateral part and the upper border of the arch of cricoid cartilage, okay, and gets inserted into the front of the muscular process of the arytenoid cartilage. Okay, so clear about lateral cricoarytenoid origin insertion. Then if you see the action, it helps in the adduction of the vocal cord. So if this muscle contract, okay, so it results in shortening and relaxing of the vocal fold. This is the vocalis muscle, which is attached to the vocal process. Vocal ligament will be here. Okay, so this helps in the shortening and relaxing of the vocal fold. So how we do this action? The next picture you can see. So the first picture you can see, this is a posterior cricoarytenoid. When the posterior cricoarytenoid contracts, okay, so if it contracts, what happened? So it contracts, it pulls the arytenoid backwards. So you see, it pulls the arytenoid cartilage backwards, and it helps, it assists the cricothyroid muscle to lengthen the vocal cord. It lengthens the vocal cord here. So this way, now you can see this space between the two vocal fold, this space is called rhina glottidis. So now see the shape of the rhina glottidis, it becomes enlarged triangular in shape. So when the posterior cricoarytenoid muscle contract, the airway or glottis opens, okay, and the shape of the rhina glottidis become enlarged triangular in shape, okay. So now see the next picture. So when the lateral cricoarytenoid muscle contracts, okay, when the lateral cricoarytenoid muscle contracts, it brings the tip of the vocal process together. You can see this is the vocal process. So it brings the tip of the vocal process together. So it closes the rhina glottidis. Okay, it closes the rhina glottidis. So this is done in whispering and in a low pitched voice. Okay, this action happens in low pitched voice and in whispering. Okay, I think now you are clear about the actions of the posterior cricoarytenoid, lateral cricoarytenoid. So posterior cricoarytenoid abduct the vocal cord and help in the opening of the airway. Lateral cricoarytenoid, okay, it adduct the vocal cord. Okay, so thus this is helpful in the whispering voices and then the low pitched voices. Okay. So next we'll go on to the next muscle, that is the oblique carotenoid. So you can see the oblique carotenoid here. Okay, so this is the oblique carotenoid. So the oblique carotenoid arises from the apex of the arytenoid cartilage. Okay, this is the apex of the arytenoid cartilage, and it gets attached to the lateral part of the arytenoid cartilage itself. Okay, so the both the arytenoid both the oblique arytenoid will cross here. Okay, so the oblique arytenoid, okay, it starts from the muscular process of one arytenoid and goes to the apex of the other arytenoid. Okay, so this is how it continues above with the ary epiglotticus muscle. Okay, so the oblique carotenoid above, it continues with the ary epiglotticus muscle. Okay, so now what is the function of the oblique carotenoid muscle? Actually, it mainly, by contraction of the oblique carotenoid, it contracts the ary epiglotticus, which is the content of the ary epiglottic fold. This is how it closes the laryngeal inlet. This closes the laryngeal inlet. You can see the attachment of the oblique carotenoid to the muscular process of arytenoid cartilage. Okay, and okay, so now the function here is it closes the laryngeal inlet. Okay, so that's how these two muscles, oblique carotenoid and ary epiglottic muscle, acts as a sphincter of the laryngeal inlet by adducting the ary epiglottic fold. Okay, the same action you can see here. Then next we'll go on to the next muscle, that is a transverse arytenoid, which is the only unpaired muscle of the larynx, which is present anterior to the oblique carotenoid muscle. And if you see the direction of the fibers, it is directed, the fibers are directed transversely. So it extends from one arytenoid cartilage to the other arytenoid cartilage. So it arises from the posterior surface of one arytenoid and gets inserted into the posterior surface of the another arytenoid. So it starts from one arytenoid and end in the other arytenoid. So now this transverse arytenoid, you will see anterior to the oblique arytenoid muscle, which is the only unpaired muscle. So this muscle helps in the adduction of the vocal cord. This muscle helps in the adduction of the vocal cord. Okay, so now you can see this is a posterior cricoarytenoid, posterior arytenoid. It is also otherwise called interarytenoid muscle, and it helps in the adduction of the vocal cord. Okay, so next we'll go on to the next muscle, that is a thyroarytenoid muscle. So the thyroarytenoid muscle, where it is located? Okay, so actually, if you see, it is located lateral to the vocalis muscle. Okay, so this is the thyroid cartilage, and you can see one lamina, this is other lamina. This is the posterior surface of the anterior border of thyroid cartilage. So this is called thyroid notch, and here the projection is the thyroid angle, and here is the vocal process. This is the vocal ligament. Okay, next to the vocal ligament, you can see the vocalis muscle, and this is the arytenoid cartilage. So now the thyroarytenoid is located lateral to the vocalis muscle, okay, in the posterior part of the thyroid cartilage, which extends from the thyroid cartilage to the arytenoid cartilage. That's why it is called thyroarytenoid muscle. So now if you see the origin, it arises from the thyroid angle, posterior part of the thyroid angle, and even it arises from the adjacent cricothyroid ligament also. So the fibers are directed backwards and gets inserted into the arytenoid cartilage. Which surface? Anterolateral surface. So no need to remember the surface and all. If you know it is arytenoid cartilage, that is enough. Okay. So clear about the thyroarytenoid muscle. Okay. So in the next picture, after removing the thyroid lamina, you can see the thyro arytenoid muscle here. This is the thyroarytenoid muscle. Okay, so this thyroarytenoid muscle, mainly it relaxes the vocal cord. Thyroarytenoid muscle, it helps in the relaxation of the vocal cord. Okay, and after thyroarytenoid, we'll see about the thyroepiglotticus muscle. So this muscle, you can see after removing thyroid lamina, this is the thyroepiglotticus muscle. So the thyroepiglotticus muscle also arises from the thyroid angle. Okay, And here you can see it is arising from thyroid angle and gets inserted into the epiglottis, lateral margin of the epiglottis, deep to the area epiglotticus muscle. So that's why it is called thyroepiglotticus muscle, extending from thyroid angle to the lateral margin of the area epiglottic fold, that is the lateral margin of the epiglottis. Okay, so this is another content of the area epiglottic fold, thyroepiglotticus. So this muscle, along with the one muscle, what is the name of this muscle? This muscle is the area epiglotticus. This muscle is the area epiglotticus. So this area epiglotticus, they closes the laryngeal inlet, but this thyroepiglotticus, it opens the laryngeal inlet. Okay, so laryngeal inlet is opened by thyroepiglotticus, it is closed by the area epiglotticus and the oblique arytenoid. Okay, I think now you are clear about the two muscle, thyroarytenoid and thyroepiglotticus. Okay, so next we'll go on to the next muscle, that is the vocalis muscle. Okay, so the vocalis muscle, as the name said, so it is closely related to the vocal fold, okay, our vocal ligament here. So you can see in this picture, again, this is the thyroid lamina only, this is the thyroid angle. You can see the vocal cord, this is the glistening vocal cord or vocal ligament, and here is the vocalis muscle, okay, lateral to the vocal cord. And this muscle is, what is the name of this muscle? So this muscle is the thyroarytenoid muscle. Later to that, you have the thyroepiglotticus muscle. Okay, so now this vocalis muscle arises from the thyroid angle and the anterior part of the vocal ligament also. Okay, and gets inserted into the lateral surface of the vocal process here. Okay, so starts from thyroid angle, inserted into the lateral surface of the vocal process. Okay, so now if you see the action of the vocalis muscle, this helps in the relaxation of the vocal cord. This helps in the relaxation of the vocal cord. Okay, so actually, so this, if this vocal ligament, because of the contraction of the vocalis, so there will be tension in the vocal ligament, which helps in the modulation of the voice, like the fingers of the violinist. So this is an important function of the vocalis muscle. Okay, so now I think you are clear about the muscles of the intrinsic muscles of the larynx. So they are grouped into two, one which acts on the vocal cord, other which acts on the epiglottis. So the muscle which act on the vocal cord are again grouped into two, one which abduct or adduct the vocal cord, other one which tenses or relaxes the vocal cord. Okay, so the muscle which abduct the vocal cord is the posterior cricoarytenoid, which adduct the vocal cord is the oblique arytenoid, then transverse arytenoid, and you have, these are the two muscles. Then if you come to the tensor and relaxer of the vocal cord, tensor of the vocal cords are two, that is the cricothyroid and one more muscle, that is the thyroarytenoid. And if you see the relaxer of the vocal cord, that is the vocalis muscle. Okay, so the muscles which act on epiglottis are grouped into two, that is, which opens the laryngeal inlet, which closes the laryngeal inlet. So the closure of the laryngeal inlet is done by two muscles, oblique arytenoid, and other one is area epiglotticus. The closure of the laryngeal inlet is done by the thyroepiglotticus. So I think now we are clear with the muscles of the intrinsic muscles of the larynx, which is an important 5-mark question. So out of this, two muscle, posterior cricoarytenoid and cricothyroid, will be asked in 5-mark question. Okay. So now we'll go about the nerve supply of all the muscles of the larynx. So they are called as motor nerve supply of the larynx. So in this picture, first orient the picture. Okay. So you can see the hyoid bone. And this is the thyroid cavity. This is the lateral view of the larynx. You can see the thyroid gland here. So this muscle is the thyrohyoid. And here you can see the cricothyroid. This is the inferior constrictor muscle. Okay. Now this membrane, which connects the thyroid cartilage, upper border of thyroid cartilage, to the upper border of hyoid bone body. This membrane is the thyrohyoid membrane. You can see the two structures are piercing the thyroid membrane. There is the superior laryngeal nerve and vessels. Okay, so the superior laryngeal nerve is a branch, sorry, internal laryngeal nerve and superior laryngeal vessel. So the superior laryngeal nerve is a branch of the vagus which divides into internal laryngeal and external laryngeal. This is the external laryngeal. So now if you see, all the muscles of the larynx are supplied by recurrent laryngeal nerve. So this is a recurrent laryngeal nerve. Okay, so in the left side it arises in the thoracic cavity, right side it arises in the neck, that you know the course. Okay, so all the muscles of larynx are supplied by recurrent laryngeal nerve except cricothyroid muscle, which is supplied by the external laryngeal nerve. Okay, so I think now you are clear about the nerve supply of the intrinsic muscles of larynx. Okay, so one more peculiarity. So all the intrinsic muscles are located inside the cartilages in the cavity, but only one muscle which is located externally is the cricothyroid muscle. And this cricothyroid muscle is also otherwise called tuning fork of the larynx, or it is also otherwise called tensor of the vocal cord, so which alters the tone and the pitch of the sound. Okay, so now with this I'll finish this class. Do you have any doubt? You can clarify now.